If you didn't get one of those, put your hand up and Bruce or Luana will get you a copy of that. Also, we'd like for you to let us know you're here today by filling out the attendance pad. Just kind of drop that off. Today I'm wrapping up the sermon series talking about improving our praying lives. I've kind of touched on some of the subject matter of what we can do in practical ways to transform our praying lives, to bring it into a, I don't want to say more effective sense of prayer, but things that we can do on a practical level to transform or change the way we come into prayer and bringing ourselves into the presence of God. Real quick in review, talked about the first time, you know, the first week, we just need to start doing it because prayer is easy. It's intended to be easy, and so we can start praying anywhere at any time. Secondly, I said if we want to truly improve our praying life, we might want to look instead at changing the environment in which we pray, changing how we approach that time of prayer and how we focus ourselves in that. Third week, I talked about using different models of prayer, and there's still a few copies of that back there on the table back on the back. Using different models to focus our time, to bring ourselves fully into the time of prayer. I said we need to get to know ourselves. We need to understand who we are, our strengths, our weaknesses, those things that make us unique and powerful. Because if we know ourselves, our prayer life will have more vitality and it will have more energy. And then last week I talked about the need to pray specifically, to get as specific in our prayers. Because when we pray specifically, we are better equipped to partner with God in those prayers and seeing how they unfold. We are better equipped to understand what God's will is when we pray for things. And finally, we are better equipped to understand or see more clearly when and how God answers those prayers. And that's what brings us to today. The last sermon in this series deals with the subject of God answering prayer. There is a foundational statement that we need to write into our belief about prayer, and that is God answers all prayers of all people in some way. God answers them in a way that is unique to the circumstance, in a way that is unique to the person, in a way so that they will know that God is the one that is doing the answering. But it takes discernment. It takes a figuring out to know what that answer is. It takes an awareness of what God's will is and how God's work to be able to see that prayer unfolding in our reality. When we talk about God answering prayers, we're talking about bridging a gap between the physical and the spiritual or the glorified. We're talking about bridging a gap between, you know, what we can see and feel and touch and God who is beyond all that, God who created all that, God who brings things into reality maybe a little bit differently than we understand. The Bible has been consistent from the very beginning that God answers prayers. There is no deviation from that, but how God answers those prayers is a little bit different from time to time and specific situation to specific situation. And that's probably why we still talk about the question, does God answer prayers in the church today? Because God does approach answering prayers so differently and in such a wide way that sometimes we miss it when God answers those prayers. The Gospel of John, chapter 14. Gospel of John, chapter 14. This is John's account of the last night before Jesus is crucified with his disciples. John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 8. Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Will you join me in a spirit of prayer? Almighty God, we do believe that you answer prayers. But we also know that we fall short in wisdom and understanding in how you accomplish that. And sometimes when we do not see or we do not hear the answer to our prayers, we become frustrated. We get upset, disappointed. We may get angry. We may lose faith and turn away. But God, you are faithful, and you are true, and you are good, and you are love. So however you answer prayers, help us to believe that it truly is a reflection of your character and your nature. That whatever the answer may be, if we cannot see it or we cannot hear of it, it is still an answer for good. And it is an answer given in love. And when we do see your answers, let us receive them in joy and in hope and in the faith that grows because we see your hand at work. In this message, may my words be yours, that I would speak wisdom and truth according to your will and your word. And may our hearts and minds have the ears to hear and the eyes to see the great and mighty deeds that you accomplish in this world when you answer prayer. I pray these things in your name, Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. Jesus is spending this last night with his disciples, and Philip interrupts what's been happening. And basically he says this. It seems so short in our scriptures, but this is the essence of what Philip is saying to Jesus. Look, Jesus, we've spent 3 years with you. We've walked with you on the roads. We've traveled with you through the towns. We have seen you do some great things. We've seen you heal. We've seen you cast out demons. We've seen you bring the dead to life. We've heard you teach with authority as no one else speaks. We've heard you talk about the relationship between you and the Father. We've followed you all this time, and it has been so wonderful, but we'd really like for you to show us God. If you do that, that will be enough. I think sometimes when we go to God in prayer, we're saying basically the same thing. God, I believe in you. God, I know you do great things. God, I know you answer prayer. But if you'll do this, I will believe in you more. I'll understand you more. I'll be closer to you if you do this. Sometimes that's what it sounds like when people are asking for things. Philip just says, God, Jesus, if you'll show us God, that would be enough for us. And I can understand Jesus getting just a little bit testy. What do you mean, Philip? What do you mean that would be enough? Haven't you seen me? Haven't you known me? Haven't I convinced you that I and the Father are one? Haven't I convinced you that what I'm doing is what he has been doing? What I say is what he is saying? Haven't I convinced you of that? Isn't this enough? I think when Jesus gets down to that couple of lines there toward the ends, when he says, anything you ask of me, I will do it. He's saying that in an earnestness. If you ask me something, I'll be glad to do it. But he's also speaking out of that frustration. But if you're asking for something that really has no bearing on who I am, I'm not going to do it. You can ask me to do anything, but if it is not about the union between the Father and I can't do anything about that. If you ask me to do something and it does not reflect the nature of the work that I've been doing in the world, I can't do anything about that. If you ask me to do something and it does not glorify my Father, then I don't want to have anything to do with that. If you ask me to do anything, but you're not doing it out of love for me or love for God or love for others, I will not do it. Because quite simply, Jesus doesn't answer a prayer that will divide the union of God. What Philip was asking was, Jesus, we know that God is with you, but God's better. We want to see God. He's dividing them. He's putting Jesus in a secondary place, and he says, I and the Father are one. If we pray for something that doesn't continue what Christ has done in the world to build the kingdom, to declare the kingdom, to bring healing to the sick, to bring release to the oppressed, to bring restoration to the lame, to bring forth life out of what is broken, if it doesn't continue that, then why would Christ be a part of it? If he didn't do that when he was here, why would he do that in an answer to our prayer? If it doesn't glorify God, which we are supposed to do with our whole lives, why would he answer that? And he told us, this is what I expect of you. This is what I think that you are supposed to do with your life. You are to love God with everything that you are, and you are to love others. That means love the people you're bonded to, whether family or friend. It means being loving toward those people who are like you. It means loving toward those people who are not like you, and it means loving toward those people who want to do you harm. You are to love God and love others and love me. And if what we are asking is not in tune with love, we're not following his command. We're not following his order. Let me ask you this. Imagine for a minute you're employed and you walk into the boss's office one day and you say, the bathroom isn't clean. You need to do something about that. What's that boss going to do? Might tell you to go clean it, or might pull out the job description that says, this is what you're supposed to do. See, if we confuse what God is doing in the world by saying, God, we expect you to do this, and yet he has no part of that, it's not going to get done. He's not going to accomplish that. God will not answer prayers. Christ will not answer prayers that goes against the essence of who he is. But I think this is where some Christians kind of wander off the path when it comes to answering prayers. I think that some Christians, they take these lines where Jesus says, if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. And some Christians take that at face value and they say, anything I ask in Jesus' name, Jesus will do it. There's no understanding of the nature of God and Christ's union. There's no understanding of the work that Christ has done. There's no understanding of God's glory. There's no understanding of love. They just say, anything I ask, God will see it done through Jesus Christ because I prayed in his name. And that's wrong. There is no way that Jesus is going to do something that is contrary to the nature of God, the glory of God. There is nothing that Jesus is going to do that falls outside of the work that he wants to do or falls outside of the love that he has commanded us to have. Not all things qualify for Jesus to answer them. Well, Jesus may answer them, and I'll get to that in just a second. I fear that believers have understood this to mean that God is the one that does all the work, that when we pray in Jesus' name, it's like, okay, it's in your hands, God, take care of it. Have you ever heard anybody say that? They say, I prayed, it's in God's hands now. God has chosen us to be the means and the method of transforming the world. We don't just hand jobs off to God and say, get her done. God looks at us and says, here's your job description. I fear that some Christians understand this to mean that God will do whatever they ask in the time and in the way they want it done. They will pray for something and they'll have a timeline in mind and they'll say, okay, God, you've got this amount of time to get this done, or you need to accomplish it in this way. And the funny thing is, God's not going to come to our snaps. God will answer that prayer, but maybe God will not accomplish it in the time or the manner we think is appropriate. Have you ever prayed for patience? Don't. God will answer that prayer every time. You will not like the means by which it's answered, and you will not like the time in which it is answered. But God will answer that prayer. God will teach you patience. We need to get our understanding of how God answers prayers back in control. We've wandered too far from the intent of what the Scripture says. And we've also kind of gotten a little too simplified in talking about how God answers prayers. I grew up hearing that God answers prayers in three ways. Yes, no, wait. You ever heard that before? But that's how God answers prayers? I don't think God's that simple. I don't think prayer is that simple. I don't think we can simplify that easily. Because quite simply, when we are involved in prayer, there's another dimension to it. By just saying God answers prayer, yes, no, or wait, that puts it all on God. That is the expectation that God's going to take care of it in God's time, and we don't have anything to do with that. But God uses us to answer prayer. God uses us to bring about things in the world. So when God answers prayers, it is fully in connection with the dimension that we play in how that prayer will be answered. And that's where this comes in. This is a work in progress, y'all. This is just an idea that I came up with. Just to kind of point out how God does answer prayer a little more complex than yes, no, or wait, but in a direct and boundaried way of answering those prayers. So across the top there, that's God's part of it. And down the side is our part of it. So when we go to God in prayer, when we have a prayer request and we come to God and we ask it of God, we can kind of use this as the beginning of understanding how that answer really does impact our life. So for example, we ask for something and God says, no, I won't, and no, you won't either. I think this is talking about what I just said, that if we ask something that is not in keeping with the union of God, it's not in keeping with Christ's work, it's not in keeping with the glory of God, it's not in keeping with love that we've commanded to being commanded to fill out, God's going to tell us, no, I won't do it, and no, you won't do it, because it goes against who I am. It is not the kind of prayer that I'm going to answer. It is not something that I would do. You can ask and ask and ask, but no, no. How do we talk to kids? When they ask something or they get into something they're not supposed to be in, no, no. This is God's no, no. These are the kind of answers that God says, no, if it's not a part of me, I'm not going to let it be a part of you. You're not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. End of subject. And if we keep going back to ask that same thing, these are the kind of prayers we will consistently get a no, no answer. Going across the top there, what if God tells us, wait, I need to do something, but you're not going to have any part of it? There have been times when God has said, I'm going to do something about it, but it's not going to include you. David and the temple are a perfect example of this. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, 1 through 17, God goes before David goes before God and says, I want to build a temple. I want to build a house for you in Jerusalem. I want to build a place where you can be worshipped, where you can be glorified. And the prophet says, David, go ahead and do that. But that night, the prophet is at home in prayer, and God says, you need to go tell David something. So the prophet goes back to David the next day and says, here's what God wants you to know about this temple. God is going to have a temple one day. God is going to have a place where people will come to worship him. But you're not going to build it. Now we're talking David. David who had faith. David who had love in God. David who we look to as an example of the passion that we can have in our relationship with God. I can see that heartfelt desire to want to do something, to glorify God, to honor God by building this beautiful place. God says, I want that, but it's not up to you. I will see that it gets done, but you're not going to be a part of it. And God will tell us that. God will say, you know what? This is going to get carried out. This is going to be taken care of. But you're not going to be part of that. You're not going to be included in how I'm going to fulfill that. It's just going to take some time to get that done. Then we go over to the last one over there. God says, yes, I'm going to do it. But then says explicitly, no, you're not. I think this is miracles. I think this is how God deals with miracles. We ask for something, you know, and all of a sudden God breaks the laws of nature. God busts through the created world and all of a sudden something strange happens. This, for me, the picture that came to mind when I thought of this was Moses standing on the edge of the Red Sea. And if you go to Exodus chapter 13, verses 14 through 18, Moses has been standing on the Red Sea and he's talking to the children of Israel. You know, the Red Sea is right there. Pharaoh's army is coming after them. And the people are crying out, we told you something like this was going to happen. Why didn't you stop and get directions to go a different way? Moses says, don't worry about it. God's going to take care of it. If we stand right here, God's going to take care of us. God's going to wipe out the enemy. God's going to take care of that army. And God says to Moses, are you nuts? By the way, that's the Todd version. You won't find it in any of your published ones. He says, are you nuts? You are going to take these people forward. You're not going to stand there. You're going to move. And then I'll take care of the army. And sure enough, the seas open up. Moses wasn't expecting that. Moses says, we can stand here and God will take care of them, like he'll come in with a big hand and wipe them off the face of the earth. God says, no, you're going to keep moving. I'm going to take care of this. You're going to go across. I will deal with them. And he did. But he says, I'm going to take care of it, not your way. I'm going to do it my way. You sit back and watch. I'll take care of this. So we go down to the next line. God says, nope, and we have to wait. God says, no, I'm not going to answer that. You're going to have to wait this one out. This is Job. Job, who had everything taken from him. He had his fortune taken away. All of his children were killed. His body was racked with disease. And he cries out to God in Job 6, 8 through 13, God, kill me now. Just wipe me off the face of the earth. And if you're not willing to do that, at least give me pain that never goes away. God says, no, I'm not. Because you need to learn something, Job. You need to understand something. How many times have we been in a situation where we didn't like where we were and we prayed for God to take it away from us and we kept praying for God to take it away from us, but eventually we got on the other side of it and we realized how much we grew in that time. That's this kind of prayer. God says no and tells us to wait. Right in the middle we have wait, wait. God has a time for things to be done and we have to wait for that time to be revealed. I think this is when we learn to rest in God. Isaiah chapter 40. Many of you probably have this better memorized than I do. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. They who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. We rest in the Lord when we have to wait. Rest does not mean that we just sit there on our hands and do nothing. That's not waiting. Waiting is, I think, what Jesus means when he tells the parable of the nagging widow. Are you familiar with that parable? It's called the persistent widow in most modern translations. I think nagging gets to the heart of it a lot better. Jesus tells a parable. There was a woman in this town. She was a widow. And she wanted justice for some wrong that had been done. And she goes to the judge, the leader, the ruler, the elder in that town, and says, I demand justice. And he won't do anything. And it says that the widow keeps coming back to him constantly. I demand justice. I demand justice. I demand justice. And finally, the judge says, you know what? If it'll shut you up, I'll give you what you want. Now, that's, again, the Todd version. You won't find that in modern translations. But the judge says, because you are so persistent and you are nagging me so much, I'm going to give you what you ask. That's the kind of resting that we are supposed to be doing when God says wait and wait. We are supposed to be constantly coming back before God. We are to be coming back and seeking God out, striving after God, moving after God, trying to find where God is in this thing that we want. We have to discover from our point of view what it is that God would want to have done. And so we move into that seeking God in a very powerful way. There's another experience of waiting that deeply spiritual people have encountered. And it's a period of silence where it feels like God has retreated from them, where it feels like God has taken a step back. And no matter how hard they pray, no matter how hard they strive, they just can't experience that presence of God. Now, it's not a lengthy thing. It is a short period of time. But for these people, when God comes back, it is an overwhelming experience of the presence of God. It is an overwhelming time of saying, look at what you missed. But because you believed and you remained faithful, I'm giving you more. So, God sometimes waits and asks us to wait. Sometimes when we pray, God says, yes, I will do it, but it's going to take some time on your part. Babylon. The people of Babylon. The Jews who were taken to Babylon. In Jeremiah chapter 29, he writes a letter to the captives in Babylon, those godly people, the people of Israel, the people who had been carried off into captivity. He writes this letter and he says, I want you to know something. God is going to bring you home. God's going to bring you back to the land that you've been promised. God is going to restore you in 70 years. God's going to do it, but you're going to have to wait. God's going to do it, but it's going to be unfolded in God's time. You cannot rush it. And that's difficult. It's hard to have that much faith to believe that God will be faithful through that length of time. But if God says, I will do it, and we believe, then we have something to hope for. Have you ever prayed for Jesus to return? Have you ever prayed for that day when the kingdom will be unveiled in its fullness? Have you ever prayed for the time when the rule of the world will be overturned and God will rule in full authority? God says, I'm going to do that. You need to wait for it. All right, moving down to the last line. God says, no, I'm not going to do it, but you are. God says, you know what? I believe what you're asking for is something that needs to be accomplished, but I'm not going to do it. You're going to accomplish it. And this is the truth about witness and evangelism. God wants people to believe. God wants people to know who God is. But God is not going to just radically pop into their lives. God is not going to just randomly change their thought patterns. God is going to entrust a proven method of witnessing to people. God is going to entrust the process that has been already signed off on and put into practice within the world. What is the means by which people hear about God? Take a mirror out and look into it. We are that means. We are the means by which the name of God is spread through the land. We are the means by which Jesus Christ is introduced to people. We are the means by which we let people know that there is a God who is loving and full of grace and forgives. We are the means by which others come to a moment where they realize that they are not complete in themselves, but there is a God who loves them and wants to complete them. We are the means of evangelism. Every one of us. So if we pray, God, I want this person to know Christ in their life, and we are not doing anything for that person, God's going to say, that's your job. That's what I ask you to do. When Jesus left town, he left the job description. That was part of it. You do it. Now, I will help you to do it, but I'm not going to make that happen. That's why you're there, to go and witness and share the good news. What if God says, wait, and yes? It means God is waiting for us to do something before God's going to work. Jericho's a great example of this. You know the story of Jericho, right? God's people, they cross over into the promised land, and Jericho's there, and it has these great big formidable walls, and there's no way they can knock it down. But God comes to Jericho and says, I got a plan for you. Here's what I want you to do. 7 days, we're going to work this out. For 6 days, you're going to walk around the city one time. But on that seventh day, you're going to walk around it seven times. And the seventh time you get around that, you're going to blow your horns, and you're going to shout, and then the walls are going to come down. And sure enough, every day, they get out, they walk around, they go back to their camp. 6 days. Seventh day, they walk around it seven times. They stop. They start blowing the horns. They start shouting. And the walls fell. Now here's a question for you. Would it have been possible for God to knock the walls down before they ever got there? So why did it take 7 days? Because God needed Joshua and the people to act, to see the power that God could bring. Sometimes we have to act before God can work. And lastly, when yes and yes come together, when God says, I'm going to do something, you're going to do something, and we're going to do it together, it's going to be powerful. It's going to be amazing. It is going to be transforming. When we are in union with God and trying to accomplish something, nothing can stand in our way. That's why I think Paul is a great example of this. Paul is a great example of God and person walking together and being in complete power and authority together to accomplish the thing that is being prayed for. Paul wanted to be able to spread the message. Paul wanted to see the world transform. And guess what? When Paul and God got together, some great things happened. The world was changed because of Paul. The world was transformed because one man had the willingness to partner with God in doing something, and God used that man to spread a message across the world that changed it. I firmly believe if Paul had not been in concert with God, if Paul and God were not working together, if Paul were not on the scene, if Paul got back up on the donkey and went into the city of Damascus and started persecuting the Christians, I do not feel that the world would have been impacted nearly as greatly. Oh yeah, God would have caused other people to rise up. But there was something perfect about Paul in the way that he brought his power in with what God wanted to do. He transformed the world. Asia Minor, Paul's influence. Greece, Paul's influence. Rome, Paul's influence. And through Paul, Rome spread into the world. It took about 200-something years for Christianity to become the religion of the kingdom. But that was under Paul's influence. So, like I said, this is a work in progress. I think prayer is probably more complex than this. This was just an exercise to let you see that sometimes prayer isn't answered nearly as simply as we think. And when God does answer prayer, sometimes we are a necessary part of it. Sometimes we are an integral part of what God wants to do in order to answer that prayer. I'm not an expert on it. I'm not an expert on prayer. Quite humbly, I would say I'm not that great at it just because I trust God. I don't trust myself. All I can do is come before God in my very limited form, in my limited understanding, in my limited ability, and just ask God, I need you to do what you do. And however I can be a part of that, let me be a part of it. Just give me the power to do it. Maybe that's where we need to start. God, I don't know. But here I am. Use me.